Buongiorno a tutti. E prima di iniziare facciamo la solita verifica di audio e video. Per piacere, ho avuto un po' di problemi nella chiusura dello stream precedente. Perfetto, grazie, benissimo. Aspettiamo ancora un momento perché vedo che appunto ho aperto lo streaming adesso, quindi aspettiamo che un momento che si connettano altre persone. English, of course. Thank you very much. All right, let us wait. I won't just wait a few more minutes. Because I opened the stream quite late this time. And in the meanwhile, if there are questions on what we saw last time or also previously, please go ahead. Today we'll tackle two important things. Errors in Doppler measurements, and we will treat also ranging. We will show how range measurements are done, and we'll point out also some caveats on the use of range data in orbit determination, and combining also range and Doppler data, some subtleties that. So, the possible ways, the question is if I can say something about how the lock on the transponder is obtained. Okay? I think this is the question. How can we make sure in a two-way radio link that the transponder locks onto the incoming signal? Because imagine you are in a situation in which you have to start tracking, so you send a radio signal toward the spacecraft monochromatic. After some time, this radio signal will reach the transponder, but the transponder has to see this radio signal. And let me see if I can get some more white. I need a white page. Let me do the following. I add. A white page and do this. So remember the transponder, let us look in the frequency domain what happens. The transponder, oh, the pen disappeared. Okay. Here we are. So the transponder in the frequency space, so So we have the frequencies. And let us look at the input port of the transponder. So the signal has been concentrated into the prime focus and it arrives at the front end of the transponder, which must be also a low noise amplifier. But remember, this LNA unfortunately cannot be cooled to cryogenic temperatures. So the front end of the transponder is always, let us say, at ambient temperature. So what happens? The transponder has an internal oscillator, and when it's not in lock, it emits a frequency. So this is F in the output. Questa F is frequency in the input. And emits a frequency in the range around 8.4 GHz, okay, which however comes from an internal oscillator. All right, is the free running frequency of the transponder. The downlink frequency, F downlink, is coherently related always to the uplink frequency. We can write this relationship alpha F uplink, where alpha is called transponding ratio. For X band is 8080 divided by 749 F uplink. There is this fixed relations, is a rational number by the way in which transponders are built. Okay? So if we have an 8.4 GHz frequency in downlink, coming from the internal oscillator of the transponder. In uplink, there is a frequency called the best lock frequency or BLF, best lock frequency, which is a frequency that multiplied by alpha gives 8.4 GHz, the free running frequency. Let us call it F free running. The transponder is able to lock onto an incoming frequency if it sees in a bandwidth of a few tens of hertz. Let us say 60 Hz, a signal. So in the frequency space, there is a band around the best lock frequency, BLF, where the transponder is able to lock if it sees a signal, a sufficiently strong signal. So the task of the ground station is to make sure that the uplink frequency goes into this band. And how is this done? Typically, this is done sending a signal starting from a given frequency. This frequency is swept, so it's not constant. is swept in time, and when during this sweep the uplink signal will enter the bandwidth around the best lock frequency, the transponder will lock. Okay? Now what happens? Since the transponder, the onboard phase lock loop, has detected the incoming signal, but this signal keeps moving, okay? Because it keeps moving. Till where? Till the end of the sweeping interval. But since the transponder has locked, also the transponder will follow, the PLL will follow the motion, the sweep of the uplink frequency. We can see it in a different way. If we do a diagram where we have time here and frequency on the y-axis, suppose that this frequency here is the best lock frequency, the BLF, which is obtained by dividing the free running frequency by the transponding ratio alpha. Okay. What the ground station does is to send a series of ramps in time, up, down, and then it will try to return to the best lock frequency or close to it, because we have an idea where the best lock frequency is. Just observe the free running frequency one way, correct for the Doppler shift, the orbital Doppler shift that is known, divide by the transponding ratio alpha, and you get the best lock frequency. So this sketch is ugly, I acknowledge it. But by doing so, you see you have one chance to go through the best lock frequency here. If you miss it for some way, if the transponder doesn't lock here, you have another chance to lock here in the downlink, when the frequency is swept down, and perhaps another chance here. All this may take a time which depends on how fast you can sweep and how large is the sweep bandwidth, this bandwidth B. If the bandwidth is small, let us say 1 kHz, and generally you need not to sweep for more than that, it can take just a few seconds. If it's more, well, it will take more time. The sweep rate depends on how the transponder is built. Typical sweep rate are of the order of 1000 Hz per second, or less, depends also on the signal to noise ratio. Okay, so this is the procedure that the ground stations put in place in order to allow the transponder to lock onto the incoming signal. One thing that I probably never told you, and this is the right time to speak about, is why are we using a different frequency in the uplink and the downlink? Why do we want to separate the two signals? Well, the reason is that you want to avoid interference between the incoming and the outgoing signal. Okay? The situation is the following. You have a downlink signal, okay, which is is quite powerful, 20 watt, etc. Suppose that you use the same frequency for uplink and downlink. That's a very, very bad idea. Why? Because you have the spacecraft, the transponder inside the spacecraft, DST. You have the spacecraft here, the antenna. Okay. And you are emitting, you have the tripod, the subreflector, and everything. You are emitting an 8.4 GHz signal. Strong. If the input channel of the transponder is at the same frequency, 8.4 GHz, imagine what will happen. You will have an extremely weak signal at 8.4 GHz coming from the ground antenna, and you will certainly have reflections, some reflections from the antenna or whatever, or even in the waveguides, that will resend back part of the outgoing signal into the transponder. And since the power is much larger, we are comparing fractions of 20 watts, can be, say, even a milliwatt or a microwatt, with 10 to the minus 18, 10 to the minus 17 watt, certainly the transponder will lock onto the downgoing signal and not on the uplink. And this would produce a condition called self-lock. When the transponder is in self-lock, so it locks onto itself, onto its own output frequency or its own internal frequency, then the transponder is dead from the point of view of telecommunication, because it's not able to send any more commands to onboard data handling. It doesn't receive any signal from ground. And this situation is probably the most dangerous, the one at which designers of the transponder pay the most attention. And during tests, when they see a self-lock, there is a red alarm, really, because it means that the transponder may lock onto itself and be useless. So this situation is avoided by separating in a quite conspicuous way the uplink frequency from the downlink frequency, just to avoid interferences and self-lock. Okay, so there is another question. So we rely on the fact that a lock occurs during the sweeping. Yes, of course, we rely on that. And the system is designed to lock onto the uplink signal. Whenever the transponder sees a sufficiently strong signal in the acceptance bandwidth, this one, then it locks. Of course, there is a probability of acquisition, and the probability of acquisition is established by making many tests, 1,000 attempts on ground, during ground testing. Ground testings are essential in this respect. And you see how many times the acquisition fails. So the probability of acquisition over 1,000 or 100 sweeps must be very close to unity. If it's not close to unity, then you may fail to lock the transponder and you have to wait some time to restart the procedure. Okay? So these are important issues that I didn't mention previously. So let us return to the error budget and conclude the error budget before moving to range. We have seen the main causes of error in Doppler measurements. We were looking at the ground antenna. You have the frequencies, we have the frequency standard, which is about 10 to the minus 15. Remember the time scale over which we are talking about, that we are talking about is 1000 seconds. So 10 to the minus 15, we have seen there is this equation rho dot over C is equal to delta F over approximately equal. Is equal to delta F over F, but delta F is let me write delta rho, so the error in the range rate, and this is delta F root mean square RMS. Okay. Then if we want to transform from the column, the right column, which corresponds to the Allan deviation, also called sigma y, to range rate, we have to multiply by the speed of light. So the error in delta rho dot RMS is approximately equal to C times sigma y. And therefore, 10 to the minus 14 in sigma y corresponds to 3 microns per second, 3 in 10 to the minus 6 meters per second. All right. So these are the error sources. And let us look at the electronics. The electronics is this box. Frequency standard dominates the electronics and thermal and mechanical deformation, so things are really pertaining to the antenna. The clock is important, but even more important are thermal and mechanical deformation. You see that the receiver and transmitter chain introduce very, very little noise. Then there are in-orbit determination errors induced by errors in the station location and errors in the modeling or Earth solid tides, etc., etc. And we have to look also at what happens on board. On board, we have the electronics, transponder, and TWTA. Here are the levels. Actually, for the transponder, for the KAT, this was the specification, but we are at 3 in 10 to the minus 16, so much better than the specification, a factor of 3. The transmitter has very little influence. And of course, there are other sources of errors which are related to the buffeting of the spacecraft, unmodeled motion of the spacecraft. Okay? So propagation noises are important. I will not say much. Let us only point out one fact, that the actual optical path is the integral of the refractive index over the propagation path of the ray. If propagation is in vacuum, n is equal to unity, the refractive index is equal to unity, and the optical path coincides with the geometrical path. However, since there are media inside, along the propagation path, even for terrestrial satellites and GPS, on GPS you have the Earth troposphere and you have the Earth ionosphere, which are major sources of errors in measurements, in positioning. Then the optical path, which is what is measured in Doppler measurement, and also to some extent in range measurement, does not coincide with the geometrical path. Why? Because the refractive index, NR, can be written as 1 unity plus a correction delta NR, which depends on the effect of the media. So, in Doppler measurement, every time that you have a variation in time of delta NR, so L can be written as a geometric distance plus a delta L, which is a function of time. Why? Because the refractive index is a function of time. The ionosphere and the troposphere interplanetary plasma are turbulent media, so there are variations which are related to the intrinsic turbulence of the media. Not to speak of the fact that there are geometric effects also, because when you are tracking from a ground antenna here, of course, and you have the atmosphere here, when the spacecraft is here, this is the path in the troposphere. When the spacecraft moves to a different position in the sky, the optical path changes, of course. And also the contribution due to the media, this delta L as a function of time, changes with time. So there are several ways why the optical path changes. In any case, some part of this variation, the geometric part like this, can be computed, but the random component related to turbulence appears as noise. And I will not go into the details of the expression of the optical path for the various noise sources. Only one important thing can be the following. Let's see if let us look at this formula. This formula is the refractive index in a plasma. Omega P is the so-called plasma frequency, which is proportional. There is a handy formula, is 9,000 square root of temperature over density. Sorry, big mistake. N over T, okay? Big mistake again, forget what I told you. The handy formula is, I was writing the formula for the debye length, is, forget this part, is 9,000 square root of NE. The electron density expressed in particle per cubic centimeter. So in the Earth ionosphere, where the maximum is 10 to the 6, Ne is equal 10 to the 6 particle per cubic centimeter, the plasma frequency, and actually I should write FP here, not omega, is roughly 9 megahertz. Okay? So 9 megahertz is a small is very small if compared when compared to the frequency of the radio signal. So omega p over omega is small, and we can linearize that equation and write that the reflective index is approximately equal at microwave frequency as 1 minus 1/2 FP squared divided by F0 squared. So you see that the larger F0, so the more we increase the frequency of the radio link, the more we are closer to propagation in vacuum, because this term becomes small and negligible. Okay? Only one moment, excuse me. I have to close the door. So this is why Ka band is preferable with respect to X band or S band or L band. Okay? Because the effect of plasma is small. For the Earth troposphere, there are two contributions. One, the refractive index, look at this formula here. The refractive index has a part called the dry component, which is related to the ratio P over T. And the ratio P over T, pressure over temperature, is proportional to the density N of the atmosphere. Okay? But there is another term which is much more complicated to model, which has to do with the partial pressure of water vapor. Water vapor is not well mixed with the Earth atmosphere. You see water vapor, you see clouds, so mixing is definitely non-uniform, and this is much more difficult to model. There are instruments, specific instruments, that are placed sometimes at ground antenna to model the water vapor contribution and to calibrate this second effect. This is called the so-called wet component of the troposphere. If you want to have an idea of how much, if you take the integral delta L, okay, this is the integral of the deviation of the reflective index, delta NR in DL, this is a physical distance. Well, for a zenith path, that is to say for a propagation along the local vertical to a satellite, the dry tropospheres amount to about 3 meters. The dry troposphere, the wet troposphere, is variable from 2 to 20 centimeters and varies in time. So you may wonder, if there is a variation that large, from 2 to 20, let us say a variation of 10 centimeters in the optical path, and you divide it by 10 to the 3 seconds over a time scale of 1000 seconds. This is an extreme case of variation. This corresponds to a velocity which is equal to 10 to the minus 4 meters, centimeters per se. This is centimeters divided 10 to the 3. This is 10 to the minus 4 centimeters per second, which is at the order of 1 micron. So 10 to the minus 6 meters per second. Okay? Which is close to gives a contribution to the error budget, which is quite significant. 10 centimeters over 1,000 seconds. Okay? So corresponds to a velocity which is certainly much larger than the velocity error introduced by the electronics, and it's something that needs to be taken into account. Okay, so there are still questions. Now we change topic, so at this point the right time to answer some questions. There is one. The self-lock doesn't happen if the uplink and downlink frequencies are different. Well, first of all, the uplink and downlink frequencies by international regulations, because the frequency allocation is set by the ITU, the International Telecommunication Union, and these frequencies are always separated. However, this does not fully guarantee from a self-lock. Why? Because internally to the transponder, you know, you have all these frequencies going around, and it's always possible that a frequency generated internally ends up in the uplink channel, maybe not at 7.2 GHz, but at a lower frequency, to produce a self-lock. So a self-lock can be produced also in a different way, by a poor design of the transponder. Okay? And transponder designers, this is the number one reason of worries when they do tests, because if they see a self-lock, well, the self-lock may be due to, may not be easy to identify, and may force also to an entire redesign of part of the unit. All right. Having said that, let us start with the ranging. So, we said already, and I already showed you this, this slide, ranging is attained by modulating the carrier. While the Doppler measurement is obtained from the carrier, of course, after some down conversion stages, range has to be done, has to be obtained by modulating the carrier. Why? We said already why, because the wavelength is too small, and we cannot resolve the ambiguity in wavelength with the Doppler. So the way in which the modulation is done, we will look, there are several methods. We will describe the tone system, which is still in use by NASA. Is not the most modern one, but is also considerably simpler than the one, for example, used in GPS or in more modern deep space radio links. But it's important to give you an idea of how things are done. So let us look at this slide. The signal structure, the uplink signal that you see here, is a sinusoidal signal modulated by a ranging signal. So we use again phase modulation. We modulate the phase of the carrier. And we will see what happens when this approach is used. So the transmitted signal, okay, the transmitted signal, which will be very similar also to the received signal, will be an amplitude factor A times sine omega ct plus theta 0. Omega C is the frequency of the carrier, 7.2 GHz in the uplink. This is a phase factor which is irrelevant for the time being, plus another phase factor, M ranging of T. M, the factor M, is called also the modulation index. And in this case, is the modulation index of the ranging signal. The same scheme is used also for telemetry. We will not consider telemetry here, but bear in mind that phase modulation is used also for transmitting telemetry. So M is a number smaller than unity, significantly smaller than unity. Typical values are 0.1, 0.2. They tell us the depth of the modulation, and we will see how this appears in the spectrum. The range modulation, we have chosen a range modulation. This is an additional phase, remember? Sinusoidal, another sinusoidal function. One can use square waves as well to modulate the signal, but with the sine function, the calculations are easier because we can use famous expansion of mathematics So, we have a signal which is the sine of a sine. In the following slides, which I had written yesterday to make things clearer, generally I do all these computations on the board, on the blackboard, but this time I added these slides. So what we have to do is, first of all, to expand this sine of two terms using the usual trigonometric formulas. Let us go to this slide. Okay? So I repeated on the first line exactly the content of the previous slide. So we expand this sine as the sum of a product of sine and cosine. So we have A sine omega ct theta 0 times cosine of this argument, m ranging, and then I have to sum the cosine times the sine. So I have cosine omega c theta 0, and here I have the sine of m ranging. I've done the usual trivial trigonometric expansion. Now take a look at these terms. Let us erase everything. Take a look at this term. Cosine of m sine. And here I have a sine of m sine. Why? Because the range in modulation is a sine wave. Okay, and I've written it here. I can use a famous expansion of mathematics using the so-called Jacobi-Unger series expansion, which is written here, and I write only the two terms that matters to us. So cosine of z sine theta, which is this term. This we need in this expression. And then for this second, we have sine of m sine, so sine of z sine theta. And this is the expansion. The expansion of the first part is a J0, the Bessel function of first kind of argument z, and z in our case is m, z equal m, the modulation index, plus an infinite series starting from n equal 1 of the even Bessel function of argument z times cosine 2n theta. For the sine, the story is slightly different. We have that sine of z sine theta is 2 times an infinite series of the odd Bessel functions of first kind of argument zeta. And here I have sine of 2n minus 1 theta. So, if I replace this term and this term with this series expansion, I get the formula in this box. So sine omega c t plus theta 0, and then the series expansion in terms of Bessel function, a cosine omega c t plus theta 0, and then the other series expansion using the odd Bessel functions. Okay? So now, if you look at these terms, okay, these are frequencies, harmonics of the ranging frequency of omega rangings. So all harmonics, and is not therefore not surprising that the spectrum that we will find will be contaminated, will be no longer a pure spectrum driven by the carrier omega c, but will be a spectrum full of harmonics of the ranging frequency, and we will see how this appears in the spectrum. We will make an approximation. The Bessel functions, when the argument z is sufficiently small, and we said is 0.1, 0.2, one can use an asymptotic expansion of the Bessel functions. This is valid when the modulation index is much smaller than the square root of the order of the index of the Bessel function. So when the index is let us say 1, m has to be much smaller than 1. And we are in this regime, so approximately we are okay if the modulation index is not too large. So we can use this asymptotic expansion, this approximation, sorry, or asymptotic expansion, yes, that when p is equal to 1 is the case which interests to us, reduces to 1 over gamma of 2, this is the gamma function, multiplied by m over 2 because p is equal to 1. Now, gamma of 2 is unity, is 1, and this is m over 2. The other terms of higher order would contain, you see, terms of m over 2 to a power p, and therefore would be significantly smaller. If m, for example, is 0.2, this ratio is 0.1. For p equal 2, this is a factor 100, so 10 times smaller. And this reassures us on the fact that we can look only at the first order expansion in terms of Bessel functions. So the first term, you see, let us look at the first term. You have a J0, which is there, we cannot do anything about it. The next term, however, is of order 2. We have a J2. So P is equal to 2, and we said we could, in most cases, neglect it. So for the first part of the first term in the sum, we can consider only the factor J0 of M, because all this part can be neglected, is of higher order. For the other component, we have a J1. In fact, when N is equal to 1, we have a J1. And therefore, going back to the next slide that I showed already, we can simplify the signal structure as a J0 sine omega CT times plus T0. Okay, this is one part. And then we have this second part, 2A cosine omega CT theta 0. Here I have the function, Bessel function of order 1, J1 of m, times sine of omega ranging t plus theta. Why? Because, if we go back, here we have a term, 2n plus 1 omega ranging t, n is equal to 1, so 2 minus 1 is 1. Okay? So we can rewrite the signal with this approximation as a part which is simply the sinusoidal function of the carrier, this one. Of course, the amplitude is no longer the same, is no longer A. When we do the modulation, we change the amplitudes, and the amplitude of the carrier becomes AJ0 of M. All right, AJ0 of M. The other term, this term here, you see, cosine omega c sine omega ranging t. So we can write the product of this cosine times the sine, and let me see what time is it. It's time to stop, and I will do it in a moment. My apologies again, I want to finish this. I can rewrite as the sum of two, or the difference between two signs, one with the sum of the argument, the other with the difference of the argument. That is this case and this. And we will come back to this in a moment after the break. And I again have to apologize for being late in the break. So we will reconvene in any case at 1:25. So we will maintain the 15 minutes break. And if there are questions on what we saw, please ask, because we will go back to the module, the range in modulation. So again, if there are questions, don't hesitate to ask. Did you see this expansion in terms of, for those of you who took the telecommunication course in the bachelor degree? Were you presented with this expansion or not? Can you answer on the chat, please? I ask this every year. Let us see if this time I get the same answer. Nobody answering my question on whether you have seen the expansion in terms of Jacobi function of a modulated signal in the telecommunication course. Okay, so this is the first time. Good. It's an important part. It's a very important part because phase modulation produces harmonics of the carrier, and the demodulation of the signal is done on the harmonics, not on the carrier. Okay? So, telecommands and telemetry travel on the harmonics, not on the carrier. The carrier is used only, let us say, as a workhorse, as something that brings you to ground efficiently without too much spatial dispersion. Because you may wonder, why aren't we transmitting directly the modulation, the signal sine omega range in t plus theta? Yes, you can do it. But what is the gain of the antenna at the frequency omega ranging, which is 1 MHz? The gain of the antenna would be extremely poor. And therefore, you would lose a lot of signal-to-noise ratio. The same is true for the telemetry. So you modulate the carrier, a high-frequency carrier, in order to obtain directivity, to concentrate all the power in a relatively narrow beam. The subcarriers are close to the carrier, we will see it in a moment, and therefore do not suffer any dispersion. If you transmit the subcarrier directly, the gain and signal would be very low and signal to noise ratio very low. This is the reason why we are using carriers of higher and higher frequencies. But to transmit information, in this case, is a ranging signal, but telemetry, which is the same, telemetry has to ride on top of a high frequency carrier. This is an important concept, a very important concept that I hope I was able to convey. If this is not clear, please tell me. All right, another couple of minutes and then we'll restart. Okay, we can restart. And you may remember that when we did the coherent demodulator, we used a similar expression, only that in that case, however, this phase, the modulating phase, could be only 0 or pi. If you remember, and 0 if we had a 0, we transmitted 1 bit. If we had a phase equal to pi, we transmitted a different bit. And we used cosines instead of sine, but the situation is identical. That modulation that we saw earlier is in a sense simpler than this. Similar to a square wave, but the ultimate product is very similar because you spread the signal away from the carrier over a bandwidth. Okay? In this particular case of a sine wave as modulation, things become easier. Why? Because in the Fourier domain, and look at this plot here, in the Fourier domain, what do we have? We have seen that we have the main carrier at sine, which is a sine omega c t plus theta 0, a bit decreased in amplitude because J0 is smaller than unity. So decrease in amplitude, and where is the power going? The power is going in the subcarriers, in the harmonics. And the harmonics, the first of these harmonics, are represented by this term in yellow, okay? This term in the yellow ellipse, where we have cosine omega ct times sine omega ranging t. And as we have seen here, this can be written as the difference between two sines, one with the sum of the argument, so we have omega carrier plus omega ranging, the other with the difference between omega carrier and omega ranging. Okay, and coming back to this plot in the frequency domain, you see that this difference in frequency is equal to f ranging. Okay, So we have FC minus f ranging, FC plus f ranging, and then of course we have all the harmonics that we neglected. They would be smaller in amplitude. Quickly, very quickly become very small. Okay? So we consider it only this one. And what the ground station has to do is to isolate the ranging signal, these two components of the ranging signal, to make the measurement. And this is done pretty easily because if you beat the incoming signal with a signal of frequency FC, we have seen that we can move this entire portion of the spectrum down to zero frequency and get a situation where we have zero here, and then we have f ranging minus f ranging and plus f ranging. I don't know why it doesn't write the pen. Okay, plus and minus. This is done by the down conversion and by the phase lock loop. The phase lock loop has the effect to bring the carrier and to shift it to zero frequency. So we are left only with the ranging signal, and we will play with the ranging modulation. So let us move on, and this is the interesting part. So now the signal. We switch it to a cosine representation because I like it more. Imagine that this is the ranging signal, the ranging modulation. So omega is omega ranging. And I omitted the index ranging for simplicity. So this is the uplink modulation. The ground antenna modulates the uplink with this signal. What happens to this signal? Well, the signal is transmitted to the spacecraft and retransmitted back to ground. So the ground antenna, the transponder, remember, preserves coherence of everything. The ground antenna will receive an attenuated version of the uplink signal, so amplitude B, cosine omega, but now we have a different phase. We don't have omega T, but we are receiving the signal that was transmitted a round trip lifetime earlier. And rho uplink plus rho downlink are the uplink and downlink range. Vg is the group velocity of the signal, which is very close to C, is equal to C if propagation is in vacuum. If propagation is not in vacuum, it's slightly different from C, but in any case, this is the round trip lifetime of the signal. May not be the geometric round trip lifetime because there are media and Vg is different from C, but the round trip lifetime. So we are receiving a signal which is B cosine omega t minus tau, which is again a function of time, where tau is equal round trip lifetime and is equal to rho uplink plus rho downlink divided by Vg. Okay? So essentially, what this equation says that after a round trip light time, we receive the signal that was transmitted at time t, or vice versa, that at time t we are receiving the signal attenuated that was transmitted one round trip light time earlier. Okay? Remember that omega, which in the previous slide was written as omega ranging, is of order of 1 megahertz at most. What is the wavelength corresponding to one wavelength to 1 megahertz? Lambda is equal to 300 meters. Okay? So the wavelength or the ranging modulation is 300 meters, which is much larger than the 1 centimeter or 3.4 centimeter that we have for the carrier. How can we now measure the round trip light time, the ranging, the two-way ranging, this quantity here? Because this is our goal. Well, we do the following. We take the uplink signal, multiply it by the downlink signal, by the received signal, and integrate over time from, let us say, a time t0 to a time t0 plus capital T, and take the average of it. Okay, so this quantity is a quantity that the ground station can easily measure. For the time being, we are completely neglecting the motion of the orbital motion of the spacecraft relative to the ground antenna. So this quantity, rho uplink plus rho downlink over Vg, is a constant over the integration time, over the interval T0, T0 plus T. We will relax this assumption. We want to first make things easier, and then we'll go to more complex things. So the product of these two cosine can be seen, can be written as the sum of two cosine, in particular cosine 2 omega t minus tau, tau is the round trip light time, plus cosine, there is a omega here that I forgot, plus cosine of the difference of the two arguments. So it's cosine of omega tau. Okay? The integral, when we take the integral, you see the integral of this term is the integral of a rapidly oscillating function over a time t which contains many, many cycles. So on average, since we have this 1 over t, this quantity will be very small and can be completely neglected, pretty much as we did when we treated the down conversion of a signal. So that is neglected, or when we treated the PLL. We are left with this term, cosine omega t, omega tau, the round trip light time. Let me delete everything, all my notes, eraser pen. And we end up, therefore, with this approximate expression. Okay? The factor 2 1 AB over 2, this factor becomes from the expansion of the product of the two cosines as a sum of the two cosines. So we have AB over 2 cosine of omega round trip late time, omega 2. Okay? And in principle, we are able to compute the argument, to calculate the argument of the cosine, and therefore obtain tau. How can we do this? We do this by taking the inverse cosine of what? So we multiply, eta is a measured quantity, so we have 2 eta divided by AB is equal to cosine of omega tau. So I can write that omega tau is equal to inverse cosine to the minus 1 of 2 eta divided by AB. Unfortunately, the inverse cosine is a multivalued function, and I have to add, take into account this ambiguity. This ambiguity is a finite number of wavelengths. So I have to add here a factor 2 pi n, which is unknown. Okay? Which is unfortunately unknown. So, if I want to obtain tau, I can write that tau is equal to 1 of omega inverse cosine of the quantity which is measured at the ground station, 2 eta divided by AB, plus 2 pi n divided by omega. This is omega ranging. And if I want to obtain the range, the two-way range, I have to do nothing that multiply everything by C. So I write C here, and I write C here, and therefore I get, since C over omega, the wave number, K is omega over C. So lambda, the wavelength lambda, is equal to C over omega multiplied by 2 pi. So if I want to write an expression where the wavelength appear, I can write that the ranging, total rho, which is rho uplink plus rho downlink, is equal to, now, C over lambda is, C over omega is lambda divided by 2 pi, so lambda divided by 2 pi, inverse cosine di 2 eta divided by AB, all these quantities are measured at the ground antenna plus n lambda. Okay? So this equation is very important because it tells me that by modulating the carrier, I'm able to reconstruct the quantity rho, the range, with an ambiguity. And the ambiguity is an integer number of wavelengths of the code. If I'm using 1 MHz, it will be the ambiguity would be with multiples of 300 meters. Now you can say, okay, but we haven't solved anything because our goal is to remove the ambiguity. We need the absolute range, and the way in which this can be accomplished is relatively easy. If we use instead of a 1 MHz modulation frequency, we use a lower frequency, let us say 1 kHz, the corresponding wavelength would go from 300 meters to 300 kilometers. And navigators know for sure the range of the spacecraft to better than 300 kilometers, because we have seen that 300 kilometers, a 300 kilometer error, essentially meaning having lost the spacecraft. Okay? The accuracy must be much, much better than that. So, the basic idea is to transmit a series of tone, the first one at 300 at 1 MHz, and then of lower and lower frequencies, therefore of longer and longer wavelength, and solve the ambiguity with the lower frequency tone. Need not to be 1 kHz. The deep space network is able to transmit tone frequencies which are even below 1 kHz, around the order of 100 Hz or so, so wavelengths of 3000 kilometers. But we stop in using lower and lower frequency tones when the wavelength of the tone is comparable or slightly larger than the a priori accuracy in the orbital distance of the spacecraft. So we combine the information that is coming from orbit determination and navigation to stop the tones of lower frequencies and get an unambiguous resolution. So, to summarize, okay, all these considerations are made here. The higher frequency tone is used to attain precision. The lower frequency tones are used to resolve the ambiguity. To resolve the ambiguity. Okay? Let me, before I go to Doppler retrading, no, it's not here. I have to go farther on, just a moment. Okay. So this slide shows you what is really done in a tone system. So you see three tones. This particular implementation is not with sine waves, but with square waves. So you transmit square waves and the ground antenna correlates the received signal with the outgoing signal. And the correlation of square waves is a triangular wave. Okay? It's this one. So we start with higher frequency tones, and then we go to lower frequency tones. The lower frequency tones are good in solving the ambiguity, but are not good to attain precision. Why? Because you see, in the end, what one has to do is to resolve these peaks, the location of this peak in time. And if you have noise here, superimposed on these triangular waves, noise will make it quite difficult to identify the peak. But the difficulty is exaggerated if you are in a situation like this. We made this example already. If you want to find the maximum of a flat hill, it's very difficult to find really the peak, the top of the hill. Because you can move horizontally here and be almost at the same altitude. It would be difficult to find really the maximum altitude. But the task is made much easier if you are in a situation like this, when you have a very peaked mountain. Okay? Because if you move a little bit, from the top, you will drop immediately. So, in the presence of noise, the accuracy in the determination of the range is determined by the high frequency tones, while the lower frequency tones are used to solve the ambiguity. In other words, if I can explain again and insist on this concept, yes, when do we stop in lowering the frequency? So let us say that the ground station is here. Don't look at the lines that are drawn in the slide. Okay? I measure the range. This is the ground antenna, the ground station here. And I have the spacecraft here. Okay? This is the true range. The spacecraft is here. I do a range measurement with a high frequency tone. And I get an ambiguity of, we say, 300 meters. So 300 meters, I write it here, 1, 2, 3. The spacecraft can be in any of these locations. Let me. So the spacecraft is more or less in the middle of this interval, can be here, can be here, can be here. Because we have this ambiguity, okay? So with respect to this 300 meter wavelength, it will be intervals, it will be always in the same place, but we don't know in which interval it is. All right? Now, let me erase everything and redo the same plot. Ground station here. The spacecraft is here, but now we are using a much longer wavelength. So this is one wavelength, lambda. Then with this is another wavelength, lambda. Another wavelength, lambda. Okay. By pure chance, the spacecraft is more or less in the middle of the interval, but it was not my intention. And now we have an ambiguity. Certainly we have an ambiguity, but suppose that this wavelength, this interval is 300 kilometer. Okay? So the wavelength is 300 kilometers. The navigators will be able to know the range of the spacecraft and locate it and say it's here, plus minus an uncertainty which comes from orbit determination. So this will be the sigma in range, sigma rho. So the navigator know already a priori that the spacecraft must be at this distance and must be in this interval. Okay? So the navigators will provide us the n which appears in the ambiguity factor n lambda. The ambiguity factor will come from orbit determination. And therefore, if we solve the ambiguity, we use the other term. Let us go back now. We use the other term, which is this one. Okay. To determine the range. So n is provided by orbit determination. And the remaining part is measured at the ground antenna. Of course, the ambiguity can be resolved only if we have some a priori information. Okay, so when the factor n lambda, when let us say the uncertainty in the range becomes smaller than n lambda, we stop sending lower frequencies. So this is the condition. We need an a priori uncertainty in range which is smaller than the corresponding wavelength. Okay? Actually, I have to correct myself. It's an error. When the uncertainty in the range is smaller than the wavelength of the tone, we stop sending lower frequency tones. And we are able to resolve the ambiguity because n is provided by orbit determination, by the navigation team. All right, so what time is it? We have only 2 minutes left, not much, but when we meet on Monday, we'll finish range and start with delta DOR, and probably finish delta DOR as well. But we will see what happens in a more realistic situation. And the realistic situation, if you think, We have assumed that the round trip late time tau is constant in the integration interval, which is not for the case. Because, for example, if we are integrating over 4 seconds, which is a very short integration time, the spacecraft is moved by 120 kilometers. If the signal is weak, the ranging signal is weak, we may integrate for as long as 5 minutes, and in 5 minutes, which is 300 seconds, well, the spacecraft has moved by several thousand, 10,000 of kilometers. So we cannot assume that the round trip light time is constant during the integration interval. And next time I will show you how this problem is solved by means of a system called Doppler rate aiding, which is fairly small. And we will quit here for today. On time. I see a question on the chat, quindi therefore we may have uncertainties even of 300 kilometers on the range obtained from orbit determination. The answer is no. If you lose the spacecraft, yes, the uncertainty may be even larger. But I made an example with a frequency of 1 kHz, because it was simpler to compute. You go from 300 meters wavelength to 300 kilometers wavelength. Okay? Typically, one stops, let us say the uncertainty in the range is never larger than, say, even in the worst situation of 10 kilometers. So let us say 30 kilometers. 30 kilometers, a tone frequency which is 30 kilometers is 10 kilohertz. So we never go, I've never seen a ranging tone really lower than 10 kilohertz. The lower frequency tones are used for emergency situations when you lose the spacecraft. But say one stops at the highest frequencies that allows you to resolve the ambiguity. So another question. Therefore, all the signals, ranging signals have different F, but they stay same M. No. The N is a quantity that we need to find. Okay? Also, the N is the quantity that we need to find. Is an unknown of the problem that is solved only using a priori information. So N is different for every frequency that we are using. Because, as I showed you here, okay, as I showed you, the number N is determined by the tone frequency. Here, N is equal to 2. So we have 2 lambda plus this part, which is determined by the inverse cosine, okay? So cosine to the minus 1 of 2 eta over AB, and here I have lambda. But if you change lambda and you make it half of it, for example, half of it, In this case, both this quantity, inverse cosine, and n, which in this case becomes 1, 2, 3, 4, and perhaps 5, changes. So also n changes. So every time you change the frequency, the correct n, which gives the ambiguity resolution, changes. I will try to make a sketch of this to let you understand better how this is done. So there is another question. Then, how do we use the signal at higher frequency that has a higher precision if we don't have the same n? Because we use different, the n is determined, is changed time by time. Okay, so since you know the lowest frequency n, the question is correct. You know the lowest frequency n, and therefore you are able to locate the spacecraft with a large uncertainty. So you say it's here with a large uncertainty. When you use a frequency which is doubled, also n doubles, and so on and so forth. So you will be able to recover the actual n once you have located the spacecraft at a given distance with a large uncertainty, because with the low frequency tone, the uncertainty will be large. But you know the range with a certain uncertainty. When you use the higher frequency tone, the uncertainty will become much smaller. But you have already located the spacecraft in a given interval. So you are able to resolve the ambiguity by using these multiple frequencies. You cannot jump, if I may add something, you cannot jump from the lower frequency tone directly to the higher frequency tone. To play this trick, you have to increase progressively the frequency. Actually, what is done is the opposite. You start with the high frequency and then go to lower and lower frequencies. I will put on the slides, there is additional material as you may have seen. I will put on the slides more comments on how the resolution ambiguity is solved. Okay? So, if there are no other questions, I would quit streaming here and we will meet again on Monday. It will be another important lessons because we will see how we can do angular measurements as well. Okay? And I will show you also some examples of range rate, and angular measurements. So with this, I stop streaming and have a nice weekend. I will publish also the results of the second homework today, also on the website, and let us meet together next week. Goodbye to everyone.